We will be visiting each of the, well, 9 of the 10 townships. So we want you to be sure and try and attend as many as you can. We have what we are calling passports. And if you register and get one of the passports, your card will be punched at every one that you attend. Those with either 8 or 9 punches on that card will be eligible to win our big prize package, which right now is valued at over $600 right now. And we'll be adding to it as the summer goes along. We also want you to register because we will be giving away a door prize today. And then also, if you give us your email, we simply want to email you and keep you in contact with what is happening in Orange County. We won't give your email to or your phone numbers to anyone else. It's just a way for us to communicate with you all summer long. As I said, we have 9 of these scheduled. This is the very first one, so we hope that all of you can make it. We do have refreshments that we're going to be sharing with you, so as you're walking around, be sure and help yourself at the refreshment table. So I think we're going to go ahead and get started. And here's a little history. The Southeast Township history is vital to the overall history of Orange County. It was here in 1807 that John Hollowell, along with his friends and family, became the first settlers of what is now known as Orange County. They settled near the Patoka River, which is very close to present-day Valeene. This group had traveled from North Carolina, and they did wonderful things for the future of Valeene and its surrounding communities. In 1827, it brought great investments to the area of the Southeast Township. This was the year that the town was platted in 1827 by John Hollowell Sr. and John Hollowell Jr. 1827 was also the year that the first church was opened, holding its dedication on August the 27th, 1827. The church was located on what the settlers called the Bluff. It was originally a one-room house built from logs at a cost of $150. At its premier time, it was known as the Bluff Springs Church of Christ. It is now known as the Valeene Christian Church. Although the church has gone through different buildings and renovations over time, it still remains a house of worship on the Bluff. I believe that is this one right here, and it is lovely. The presence of churches was extremely important early on. It brought people together in the community, and in 1898, the Crossroads Church of Christ was built with dedication that very same summer. It is said that members of the Bluff Springs Christian Church had a dispute upon the use of an organ in the church. Those who disapproved of the instrument's use moved their membership to Crossroads Church of Christ not too long after it was opened, giving it a considerable number of members. The two churches together served not only as a house of worship, but a very important meeting place for different functions of the surrounding community. The Valeene Wesleyan Church, which is just right up the road, was built on donated land in 1972. Before that time, services were held in a barn across the street that had been converted into a church. It was then known as the Pilgrim Holiness Church. This Southeast Township thrived for several years. Along with Valeene, important communities were Bacon and then later Pearson Town. The Pearsons became a prominent family at that time. The communities had a country store, post office, and making it the ideal for Orange Countyans to reside. A story was told in the Springs Valley Herald in 1922 that reflected on how the little community of Bacon received its name. The story claims that a man was on his way home after allegedly stealing a side of bacon from some countryside dwelling. On his way home, he was trying to cross Patoka River where he fell in and failed to bring home the bacon. This occurrence is said to have resulted in the name of the post office as Bacon, as it was established. The communities of Southeast Township area are not populated or booming as they used to be. However, their establishment and activities were very important to the prominence of Orange County as it is today. So Orange County would not be what it is without Valeene and Bacon and Pearson Town. And we are so grateful for the families who came here and created this community and who still make it a thriving part of Orange County. So we hope that you enjoyed the day. And we're going to get started with a little lecture from Roger. And then we're going to be on our own to just kind of mill around and look at the displays. And we do want you to enjoy the refreshments while you're here. And we intend to be here until about 4 o'clock.
Yeah, so I'll stay later.
Just enjoy the day at your leisure. And thank you for coming.
I'm absolutely overwhelmed. I didn't prepare anything, didn't practice this, so I'm not sure what's going to roll off here. I do want to say this, that it was 4 years ago, many of you already know this, that Bob and Debbie Turner approached me about putting together some sort of a display to take to the music and heritage reunion that then was staged in Orleans. From that has come these displays of photographs from people here in Southeast Township. People were very good about providing photographs and helping get these displays together. It's a work in progress. It's evolving. We can just keep adding panels. You know, if folks have photographs or news clips or anything they want to submit that's relevant to Orange County and Valeene, we're always happy to receive those.
Janice Knight, my mother was a Hollowell.
Uh-huh.
And so
what was your mother's name?
Julia.
Julia Hollowell.
Okay. Yeah, and she married a Knight.
Okay.
So I was the youngest of my family. Of course, my parents are dead, but we used to come down here to the Hollowell reunions here on the... I've got the books where we had them in the 70s and the 80s.
Uh-huh.
And I'm a descendant of the John Hollowell that's buried up here. John Hollowell was the first recorded landowner here in Orange County, which it makes it kind of unique, being related to him. John Hallowell had some brothers, and so one of those brothers is our line of the Hallowells, Josie.
Yeah.
So my mother was a Hallowell, and her father's name was David Hallowell, and then his father's name was William Hallowell. Me being the youngest, I didn't know all this till I got older, and then I got to digging around. And William Hallowell, he was killed in the war, Civil War, down in Georgia. He was buried there in the cemetery. His wife is buried in the Springer Cemetery between the two caves, you know. So there's still a few, what I call, have got long roots here in Orange County, mm-hmm. which makes it nice that they can bring out some of that history about the past and how I got started here. And I think it's wonderful of whatever they can get going.
This is, I don't know if you'll know him or not, but that's Brogue Murphy, Delbert Murphy. And that's Marilyn Trinkle, Diddy Trinkle's daughter. And that's Norma Manship and Rosa Trinkle and Norma Manship.
All right. And your name is?
I used to be a Morgan.
Uh-huh.
There's another one. This was taken in front of Thomas Stroud's house. That's Roberta Stroud, and that's Norma Manship. I got two more in here. That's Violet Manship, and Ella Mae Stroud, and Norma Manship, and that's for the corner of Thomas Stroud's house. That's Ella Mae Stroud, and that's Violet Manship. That was in the middle of the street after the end of our 4-H at the Valeene School.
Okay. All right.
You can tell they're old. I've had them all this time.
So tell me who your mom and dad were.
George Morgan and Helen Lemon Morgan.
Uh-huh. And where do they live?
Valeene.
Valeene, right in Valeene.
Yep.
You're a Valeene town girl.
Yep.
Huh?
All
right.
And the oldest person I'd say in Valeene was Pearson Town, was where Pat and Robert Stroud were sort of key with that now. Because I went to school at Pearson Town in 47, 48, and 49, and they lived there then, and they're still there.
And tell me your first name again.
Maddie. M-E-T-T-I-E.
Okay, all right.
I'm the oldest of eight children.
All right. Well, thank you so much for talking to me.
You're welcome.
Hey, I'm Connie Minton, and I live in Orleans, Indiana, and I'm a great-great-grandson of George Washington Dailey. And my great-grandpa was Mort Dailey, and my grandpa was Nofel Dailey. And they made the chairs till 1910, and then some of the boys, they passed away in 19, one of them passed away in 1910, my grandpa, and the other one passed away in 1912, that George Washington Dailey.
So were these called Dailey chairs?
They're Dailey chairs. And made right here in Valeene, Indiana.
Uh-huh.
And they started making them, I think it said here, he made them in 1863 is when he started making them, I think.
Uh-huh.
And anyway, I've collected about 50 some of them, and I've got there's about 30 at my house now, but some of them belong to my kids, you know. I just got them stored up there because one of them lives in Texas, and she's got four or five, six or eight up there, and these all came out of the house just a while ago, but this one here came from my great-granddaughter. This is the first one I ever got, and anyway,
I was telling you that I have one that looks similar to that, and you were talking about my father. So
oh, yeah.
No, you talk about
no,
the connection.
He sold me a chair one day, and it was a setting chair, and it's the size, the bottom was the size of the rocker,
uh-huh.
the big rocker. It was the size of the big rocker. And Kenny, I think Kenny Minton still has that. And he sold it to me. He said, now, Connie, I stood out there in the rain for an hour and a half buying this chair, and I have to have $50 for it, he said. So I, you know, I bought it off of him. But I just love to I just love to find them, that's all.
Well, when my dad retired, redoing furniture became his passion.
Yeah.
And he would go to auctions, and you'd see him constantly with his pocket knife out, scraping on the bottom of a chair to see what kind
of
it was.
Yeah. But I can drive by a house almost, and if there's one sitting on the porch, I can tell you right from the road if it's a Dailey chair or not. And a lot of people say, well, we've got a Dailey chair. I look at it and I say, well, that's not a Dailey chair. And as I was coming down here, I was telling you, this lady, I stopped at her house, and she had three of them there. But one of them was painted black, and that was the only one that was a Dailey chair. The other two was made by somebody else, and it had flat arms on it, you know. And so I said,
what are the distinguishing characteristics of a Dailey chair?
They're got marks around each one of these down here, around the rings there. They got marks. They're scored around there. Every one of them scored. And there's no glue in them whatsoever. There's no glue. There's three nails in the back of the chair.
You can move yourself.
Yeah. There's three nails. See these three nails? Mm-hmm. This must have been put on when this was green and this was dried. Because when this ring dried around this upright, then you can't pull them apart. I mean, you can't. If you dip them, you can pull them apart. The glue, I mean, it'll come loose if you dip them. But otherwise, I can't tell you much about them. I can give you this here. You could tell when George Washington Daley started this. Starts right here. Oh, yeah, you can take a picture of that, yeah.
Yeah, this is my long-term memory.
Yeah, mine is short. I mean, I get too excited about talking about the Dailey chairs myself. And
so you've got six chairs here today. How often do you have this many?
Oh, I've got three. Oh, wait a minute, let me see how many I got left at home. I've still got 12 left at home, the Dailey chairs. They're not... I got one more rocker, and I got the rest of them straight chairs.
Well, Connie, thank you so much for taking time to let me bother you with questions.
I hope I've done all right.
Jordan Lambden.
Okay.
And my grandfather was a king, and he came to this neighborhood. And what I wanted to show you was this branding iron.
Read backwards for me and tell me what it says.
It says S.C. Lambden, distiller, Indiana District 2.
And where was the distillery?
Over by Bacon.
Where is that?
Over by Bacon.
Uh-huh.
And back then, State Road 37 didn't even exist. And so the road went down about a quarter mile east of where 37 is now, and he had a country store and distillery down there, because the reason they set up the legal distilleries, that there was southern Indiana had a lot of fruit in it, apples and pears and all kinds of orchards, and there was no way to ship them out because there was no trucks in the 1800s. So they set up these legal distilleries where they let them make brandy out of it. And then they put it in barrels and branded the barrels, and then took them down to the shipping place on the Ohio River. It was down below Eden, and shipped them out on the river to New Orleans. And so that's why they got it. That's why they had them, and they had one here in Bacon, they had one in Stamford Street, and one in a little place called Helix, and I don't know whether there was any more or not, but that's what happened.
So this was a brand to go on to oak barrels?
Yeah.
So they started the distillery because they had fruit going there, right?
Yeah, well, there was no trucks back then, and they couldn't get rid of it, so the state recognized that. So they set up some legal distilleries to make brandy, then they put it in barrels and put it down there and ship it out to New Orleans.
Yeah.
So how long did they make brandy there?
I have no idea. I run into a state historian one time, a lady, and I told her the story, and she looked at me like she didn't believe me. So I just read it and showed her this, and she said she'd never heard of it.
I never heard of it either. That's a great piece of history right there.
It's heavy too. Now originally it had a handle on it here, but my dad said when he was a kid, why he cut the handle off and then he'd crack hick the nuts on it with a hammer. So that's
your nutcracker.
Yeah, that was his nutcracker. Yeah, Daryl L. Abel.
Okay. I was born over on Owl Ridge in a log room.
And what year were you born?
1931.
1931. Okay.
Uh-huh. September the 7th. Yep. Seen a lot of changes.
So what was the characteristics of Owl Ridge?
Pretty rough.
Pretty rough?
Yeah. Oh, well. Wasn't too bad.
So did you go to a one-room school there?
Oh, yeah.
What was the school?
Number 8, Owl Ridge.
Okay.
4 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. Took 16 kids to hold a school, and the last year there was only 15, so they took us to number 9, Nubbin Ridge.
So what are some things that you remember about it as a boy growing up in Owl Ridge?
Oh, working hard, very little money. We always had enough to eat and wear. Everything was paid for. I've never figured out how they done that.
Yeah.
They bartered a lot. They didn't handle much money.
You know, when you went to church, instead of going down the road, you went through the woods, or you cut across country. Where all did you go then?
Well, we went to Cooktown Sunday School.
Yeah, but how did you get there from the ridge? Yeah, you walked, I know, but what did you pass?
We cut through there, but when I got bigger, I rode a motorcycle over there. Yeah.
And your name is?
Rita Nicholson.
Rita?
Grandma, who was Valeene Abel. I remember after she went to town and she started drawing Social Security, she drawed $30 a month. And that's what she lived on.
Well, they bartered then, you know, possum hide or some chickens, eggs, cream, roots, mayapple roots. It was different.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wasn't all bad.
So what were some of the best things about growing up in Owl Ridge?
Oh, going hunting.
Yeah.
You just step out the door, you was hunting.
So did you do any mushroom hunting when you were little? Yeah. This time of year, I always think of that. So did you tell anybody about all your secret spots?
I went north, I'd tell them I went south. I used to hunt them, but no more. Now her brothers was the mushroom hunters. Yeah, mercy.
How far was it to school?
Well, number 8 was about half a mile. You'd hear the bell ring.
You could skip to school.
Huh?
You could skip to school.
Oh, yeah.
Well, what do you think about this event here?
Well, in 50, from the centennial?
The courthouse centennial was 1950.
Okay,
yeah.
I went to sleep and missed the parade. And I woke up and I told them I'll go to the next one, which is
this year, bicentennial.
So I bought a tank of gas and here we are.
only 66 years later.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for taking time to talk to me.
Oh, yeah.
I'll try to get together with you later on, and we'll do a more thorough oral history, okay?
Are you really familiar with Indiana history?
A little bit, yeah.
When they moved Corydon to Indianapolis, the capital.
Uh-huh, 1825.
Well, I think. Anyway, my grandmother, old one, Al Holler, Al Ridge, used to tell me that they brought them records right through that road by her house, on ox carts, I guess.
Uh-huh.
I never found nothing on that.
So you're on the road to Indiana history.
Well, it could have been because Pivot Point, you know, is in line with Meridian Street.
Yeah.
And we was only about half a mile from Pivot Point Road. So they could have, it could have been some facts. I've never read anything on it.
Yeah.
Down this road here, 2 or 3 miles, I don't know, what was the, there was a spring there that you used to go get water.
Oh, that's where Dad would stop and water the horses.
Okay.
He used to go to Marengo and take ties, or he'd use. When he started home, of course, that was a long run, he'd go to sleep on the wagon. This was a dirt road then.
Tell the horses to go home?
Yeah. They'd stop when they got there.
The horse knew the way, huh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, a horse will go home. A snowstorm or anything, he'll go home. Yeah.
Now, you said Grandpa did cross ties?
Oh, yeah.
Off the farm? Or?
Yeah. And then used the... Well, they hewed them. You know, they cut in about every... Slab that off, that made good cookwood.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and the tops made good. Oh, yeah.
I'm Harold Clary, Orange County. I'm Sonny Clary.
Sonny, okay.
And everybody around here knows me as that. And married the oldest Andrew girl of Levi Andrew's family. My grandfather was raised in Green, he was born and raised in Greenfield Township. His father died when he was 10 in a logging accident, and he fell in the water in January and got pneumonia, and all their kids were passed out to different neighbors. He was, the Joshua Weenick family took him, and on the 1900 census, he was listed as an indentured servant because he was earning for, working for his board and keep. So anyhow, that's, you know, and I'd like to make contact. I was talking to Alan a while ago, and I didn't know his dad. I knew his dad personally, and I didn't know they had written a book on it. And, but I want to check up on some of the history because I was trying to find out. I don't have any of the real early history of my grandfather other than my daughter now has some maps of the area around Padoka Lake that at one time, about half of it was owned by the Eastridges, which was my grandfather's name, Ed Eastridge. Well, I'd like to keep in touch with the genealogy and learn more about the history.
Well, what do you think about the turnout?
Oh, I think it's great. Good to see all the pictures, and I've got a few pictures. I guess I need to dang it out and bring. But it's a good day for the fellowship. I'm glad to see all these people turn out here. Seeing family and friends I haven't seen in a long time.
My name is Jeff Lane. I'm the Orange County historian for the state of Indiana. I'm an Orange County native, and I live in Paoli, Indiana.
All right. And Jeff, you brought an interesting little tidbit of history here.
I have brought a picture of my grandmother, her sisters, and her parents who grew up in this house. And she is the little girl on the right here in the picture. She was born in 1909. Her mother is the lady in the dark dress sort of behind her, Minnie Hollowell Davis. And that is my connection with the original Hollowell family who came here in 1807.
Where does this picture reside?
This resides in my home in Paoli. And she actually got it from her sister, Ophie Self, who is the lady in the picture next to their mother in the back row. And there were five girls in the family. My grandmother, Eunice, being the youngest. Her sister, Jessie, next to her in age. Then probably Ophie. And then Ree, who married Lonnie King. And then this was her youngest, oldest sister, Eddie, who married Irby Patton, and their son, Zelbert Patton. And the home is still standing, and it is now, Billy Garlow now lives in the home near Concord Church.
Okay.
My name's Roy Gene Grimes.
And Roy, what year were you born?
I was born in 1955.
And your parents were?
Roy and Ida Pearl.
And where did they live?
We bought the store in Valeene from the Greshams in 1962. And then we owned it for 10 years, sold it in 72, and then Mom and Dad moved to Marengo.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to that, we lived over on Ridge up by Joe Apple Hill. So when we moved into Valeene, it seemed like we were kind of the outsiders. We weren't related to anybody. You know, most of the folks around here, they were all related in some way or fashion. And but when we moved in, they just made us feel like we were part of the Valeene family. I guess in a way we kind of were at the time. My sister was married to Doyle Gresham, who was the Gresham's oldest son. So I guess we had a little bit of a family tie, but nothing like the rest of the families in this area. You know, of course, back in the 60s and 70s, Valeene was still a thriving little community. We had the two stores, two body shops, and there was business around. Most of it was agricultural. The majority of it was, you know, people that they either worked in a factory and they came home and they worked their farm, or they worked their farm full time. This area where we're standing right now, you know, when I was growing up, it was always a cornfield. We played in the creek over here, we pretty much lived in the creek, because us boys did. You know, between the creek and the woods, that's where we stayed. You know, we didn't have things like Xboxes and computers and things to keep us busy. We made our own fun. I have some great memories of Valeene. One of them I provided to Roger Moon was the time that Bill Anderson and his band came to visit, and we put on, my sister organized the benefit for Carol Trinkle. After they did two shows that day, and after the first show, the whole band came down here to Valeene, and Bill Anderson and I, you know, at the time, in the late 60s, he was a big country star.
Mm-hmm.
Whispering Bill, that's right, that's what everybody called him. We just called him Bill. Uh-huh. He and my sister, they were friends for a long time before that, and still are to this day. And you know, he and I just sat down on the floor, and he was just as common as could be, and I thought that was great. I was a 14-year-old kid, and here I am sitting with a superstar,
mm-hmm.
drinking a bottle of the Little Coke, you know, when they still had the Little Cokes. And, you know, he asked me if we had any peanuts and if I ever put peanuts in my Coke, and I told him, well, sure. So I ran up to the store and got some peanuts and brought them back, and we sat there and had a big old time. But I mean, there were just so many memories of Valeene and these people that are gathered here today. It's just amazing to see some of them. Some of them I haven't seen in 40, 50 years almost.
Now, you mentioned Bill Anderson and the music. Do you remember any other musicians around in the area?
Oh, my goodness.
In
the Valeene area, I can remember many a times when Mom and Dad had the store. We'd have the manships, come, and they'd sit either on the front porch and pick and sing, or, you know, we'd open up the back of the store, and they'd just sit back there in the back of the store and pick and sing. And you know, it was just all the time. There was always music in this area. The Moons, they were a very musical family. You know, between the fiddles and the guitars and the pianos, there was like this church up on the hill here. Every Sunday morning, it was, you know, when it came time to sing, it was like listening to a choir, but it was just the congregation. And every church around was that way. Uh-huh. So there was a lot of music in this area.
So talk about Valeene pride that you inherited by having this store.
Valeene pride. Well, on my Facebook photo, I've got a little icon that just kind of says it all. It says Valeene, Indiana, where my story began. And that's it. You know, before Valeene, I remember a little bit of, you know, living on the farm in the country. But the majority of my memories growing up, the shape of my character, and all of that was formed by this community. And of course, my parents and family. But a lot of it came from the community. And we were always proud of our little town. And bad as I hate to say it now, when I drive through, it makes me sad. Just to see that things are not the way they used to be. There was never a yard that was unkept. There was never a house that was unkept. Now it's kind of, a lot of it's fallen into disarray. Like I said, it kind of makes me sad to see that, because Valeene was a very proud community.
Yeah.
I remember as a kid, we played football here. We had our own football team. We didn't own a set of pads among us. We owned the football. We had no helmets. We would challenge the Paola football team to come down and play us. They wouldn't do it. They were scared. They were afraid they'd get hurt. We had right over here on one of these fields, Bob Free always kept one of his fields mowed, and that was our baseball diamond.
Uh-huh.
If you hit it in the creek, that was a foul ball.
And a wet one, too.
And a wet one. Somebody had to go get it. But there was, and as far as Marengo, and Valeene was Valeene, and Marengo was Marengo. And, you know, those guys were from Crawford County, and we didn't mix with them too much. But, of course, the family's kind of intermixed now. Most of the Valeene people moved to Marengo and things like that.
Well, anything else that you'd like to talk about this occasion the history that we're trying to keep alive?
I'm just... As an old Valeeneite, I'm just glad to see that somebody's taken the initiative to put together the history of this area, and not only the Valeene area, but all the communities, small communities in Orange County. So many of these little communities kind of get forgotten over the years. Nobody really remembers, or people grow up and move away, but the people that grew up there never really leave.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just so glad to see a big turnout for today's event.
Okay. Thank you very much.
And anyway, I always had to ride Dan, he'd ride Benny. Anyway. Old Dan, he'd throw everybody off. Boy.
I'm going to go to the next one. Harper Key.
Okay.
I moved to Pearson Town in 1956, and I moved away in 2000. So anyway, I have brought with me today some early probate records, and also the church records for Rock Springs. And I think, then I also have this is for the Bluff Spring Church of Christ on the Hill, but its membership roll, and the one from Marengo, the Big Spring, and Goodman Ridge. Then in the back here, I have letters from the churches to the elders and the brethren in the conference, and there's also the conference minutes, like Lewis Byram and that group, who, he, of course, that's an Orange County person. And then in this group here, I have a will, Nancy Pearson's will, where she wills the old Pearson Mill to her children. And this is just a sample of what I've got at home.
So how did you get into scrapbooking and
doing those things? Goodness. I had, from the time I was a little girl, I made scrapbooks. And so I keep this, I have about 10 of these huge ones over here, like this one over here, that are for the United States Stars 1812. I keep them. I keep them from the Whisker Run chapter VAR. I was region at Lost River for 9 years, and so there's times that I've got even things that belong to the Lost River chapter. Mm-hmm. And I've just got stuff everywhere, and I make them for myself and for my grandchildren, and I just make a lot of scrapbooks. Now this one over here, oh, this is the Bowman family. My children's ancestors were the Bowmans and the Pearsons and the Keys, and of course their great-great-grandmother was Bessie Key, and she lived to be 104. She was the oldest person in Crawford County, Orange County, when she died. She had the Century Club here, and of course, Harold Key, with his trustee deal, you've heard of him, I'm sure. And then over.
And then you were telling me that there was a 1902 register of.
Out of the school, of the Pearson Town School. It's in this one here, right here. And if you want to take a picture of it, it's this one right here. Then I also have with me this. And this is just mainly funeral notices. And they're from several different counties. Lots and lots of early Southeast Township citizens are in here. And I just like to do that. Maybe someday somebody will want them. My children, no.
What do you think about the turnout for this event today?
Oh, it's wonderful. And they would never have been able to get them all in the basement up there. It just seemed like God intended for us to be here because the clouds, you know, went away. We've had good weather, and I'm happy that they have.
Well,
but now Elmer Key would have been my father-in-law's father. And he was a carpenter. And one time we counted about 18 different houses here in Southeast Township, right in the Valeene area, that he'd actually built or had worked on. And it's amazing because for the grandchildren and some of his children, they built houses. And one of his trademarks was the porch posts.
Uh-huh.
They were made of tubifores, and they looked like a ladder. And I think mine is the only one that's left that has the original post. The rest of them, they decided, where I moved from. Because they used to think that, I guess, they wanted wrought iron posts.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm proud of the fact that it's never been changed. I have a lot of good memories with a lot of the older people, like Lou Holiday up here.
Uh-huh.
And I used to go visit with her a lot. And Ella King and Ellen Engelman. And, you know, I just fit in with older people.
Yeah.
Rhonda Eichelberger.
Rhonda. And go ahead and tell me about this bench.
Oh, after Earl died first, after Merle died, I just figured this was a place to have a bench for them. and close to the basketball goal was, they were both into sports. Uh-huh. So, and then on the back of the bench, I had them put the Creekside Stadium and the Valeene Reds, because when we lived here in Valeene and went to church here, this was a ball field. This park was a ball field. And they called it Creekside Stadium, and they were called their Valeene Reds, and they wore red shirts.
Tell me your name.
Bonnie Free, and I married Larry King.
And you grew up here in Valeene, and you were telling me a story about getting stuck on that bridge over there.
Yeah.
So could you share that again?
My dad and brother and me had went to the Merle Grisham store that night to pick up some cookies and milk and fuel items, and it had rained a lot, and Daddy said, well, let's go down and check the water. So we did, and we parked on the bridge, and Bert Trinkle and Don Trinkle were already there. And we were all looking over at the side of the water, just wow, you know. We got ready to get in the car and go home, and we couldn't leave. Both sides had closed us in, so we were stuck on that bridge for several hours. And I can't really remember. I think Bert waded through the water and went and got his cattle truck and somehow came back and rescued us. You know, he got as close as he could, and that's how we finally got off. But the car stayed on there all night till the water went down.
And so how long do you think you were there?
Probably 2-3 hours for sure, but we ate all the cookies.
Okay, now as I was leaving, I heard you say that's another funny story.
That's another funny one.
Well, what was that?
You had about the bridge?
Well, I don't know. You were saying
Wayne Stroud, when Wayne Stroud, his mom lived up there in Valeene. He had a little building he wanted moved from Valeene down to where Doris lives now, Doris Stroud. Well, my husband Larry and my dad and everybody said, yeah, we can do that. They did it, but they started on the bridge and it scraped, stuck. That little building got stuck on the bridge. So they said, well, what are we going to do now? Because they couldn't get up the sides to do nothing. So they had to back up a little bit. And as they pulled it across the bridge, just inch by inch, they had to take siding off the building as they come. And then Daddy's old wrecker, it was in front pulling the building, the clutch kept slipping on it because he's having to go so slow and wait for them to disassemble the building, more or less. So Larry went somehow home and came way around with his John Deere tractor. No, he got in front of Daddy's wrecker with his John Deere tractor and hooked on to help Daddy out. They got it. Well, in the meantime, there was a lady come from Rango. She was going to go to Laverne's beauty shop to get a perm.
Yeah.
She was so mad she couldn't get over the bridge. She had to have that perm. So she waited the creek and she went on to Laverne's. But she turned us in, or the guys in, you know, and she got mad. She called the police. Well, they got the building over the bridge. Just when they got out of sight, here come the police. He didn't see nobody.
We don't know what
and
happened.
Wayne got his building moved.
Oh, that's good.
His little barn. I think it's a little barn.
So, yeah. So the water that runs under that bridge, how do you call that stream? What's your name for that stream?
Padoke. I said it wrong, but it's
no,
Padoke.
It's Padoke.
And it's
right.
Orange County.
And it's Orange County. All
yeah.
right. Thank okay. you, Bonnie. Those are
well,
good stories.
Yeah.
Chantel Deaton. My maiden name is England, and I was born in December of 82. So I grew up on Oak Grove Road, and I still live on Oak Grove Road. One house over from where I grew up. We rode bikes. We played outside, picked flowers over the hill. And it was my aunt was next door, and she's just 4 years older. So we had cousins on every side, and we just did what little girls do, just play outside, play house. Yeah, lots of family get-togethers and trips.
And did you cook and things like that?
Yes, go to Granny's house next door and make cookies, and anything she was cooking, we had to pretend like we were. She would give us the extra dough to cut out our own cookies and pies.
And what was Granny's name?
Violet Manship. And she was married then. It was Valeno. We live a simple life with our four kids. I homeschool. We are outside all the time. We try to live off our land. We have a garden, and the kids all hunt with my husband, and still have cousins on every side, grandparents on both sides, and just live a simple, happy life.
So you're trying to preserve the way that some of these folks that have been here are remembering.
Yes, and I've told my family, my husband and I think we were born in the wrong time because we wish the things that our parents were trying to get out of and get past and give us more, we wish we had the life that they had and that our grandparents had, just simple and, you know, without all the chaos, easy, the good old days.
Okay. I want to talk about the Manship family. Your first name is
Violet.
Violet, and your last name now is
Griffiths.
And you were born a Manship.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
We eat, played, and prayed.
Okay.
And everybody was totally happy, and we did all kinds of things. We would go to reunions and have reunions together, and our parents would make pies, and they would all be stacked in a stack like this, and then we'd cut down through it. And I don't know. We just had some wonderful times, and I would wish we could go back.
Yeah.
So how many people in the family played instruments?
Everybody.
Did you play an instrument?
Yes. They all play multiple instruments.
Probably, I would say, out of 18 children, and our parents played also, both of them, all four of them, the other one boy and his family didn't, but I would say probably 18 out of 24 could play something, and still do.
How did they learn?
Just by hearing.
So have you carried on this tradition?
Just the singing part, I don't play very well, but one of my biggest joys right now is my 9-year-old daughter goes to have days with Granny, and she teaches her new song, My Little Girl Plays by Ear, and they sit together at the piano and each play different parts of a song, and that makes me want to cry every time I watch it.
That's pretty special.
Yep, it is.
But my mother could take a song, never had seen it before, never heard it before, and she could read it and sing the tune of it from just the book without playing it. And she would teach my sister Betty how to play the tune to it, and then Betty would just take off with it, the older sister.
I'm envious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was wonderful.
But they still have parties. Granny has what my girls call old people parties that we're not invited to. And they have all the Manship cousins that Granny and Rex Manship and Mo, they come, and Granny's brother that just passed last year, and they all bring their instruments and they play and they eat and they pray still to this day. She carries that on. She's the glue.
So she's the glue that keeps the family
together. Yes. Yep.
We're getting ready right now to have an old-fashioned country boil. Have you ever heard of that?
No.
Boil?
No. I think so, but help me out.
It's where you, like, you have fish, shrimp, fried fish too, sausages, Polish sausages, and red potatoes boiled with corn on the cob.
You're going to invite us, Martha.
Sure. Bring your camera and come along.
So what you do is you take all this food, have a picnic table, put brown paper on it, and when it's finished cooking, you just throw it on that table, and everybody eats off of it with their hands, and it's delicious. And our life is centered around food and music.
Really. And God.
And God.
Yeah. Well, now, were you on the bus that traveled everywhere?
I have some of that.
Okay. Yeah. They still don't do that anymore.
No, not with a bus.
I didn't think so.
They still go.
And, they still go, but not.
Yeah. But now, Alan over there, we call him Mo. He's here.
Yeah, he just came.
He's really good on a guitar with Gail. And my brother Donnie could play anything you wanted to hear, any type music. Well, they can too. And so they're getting ready. I'm going to have another party with them at my. I have a little building out the back that was set up just like. You can go live in that building. There's everything out there. But we have parties out there where I have those kids to come in and we all play. And then we have parties with a theme where that you dress like the theme and you act like the theme.
And the young people can't come.
That's awful.
It's
the old people.
So she how said, old do you have to be to come to these parties?
I'm guessing 70.
My brother was the minister, uh-huh. And we would go to Tennessee and Kentucky, and the first time I can remember of doing anything as a family was on the streets of Marengo, Indiana, and he would preach, and we would sing, and even as little kids, you know, we would sing on the streets of Marengo, but I don't think you'd be allowed to do that now, would you? Well, we started out in the old Pilgrim Holiness Church in Valeene, Indiana. And then we
Pilgrim's moved Corner?
Pilgrim Holiness Church.
Pilgrim Holiness.
Okay.
And it's gone now, but then we went into we built a new church there in Valeene, which is the Valeene Wesleyan. And so then we kind of split, some of us, and not to mentally, but we decided we're going to stay here, and Russell was going to go up here to Rock Springs Church up on the hill. So that church had been in dormant for 50 years. So he went in there with my husband, other husband is gone now, and restored that church, and he was pastor. And so we were there. My mother, she passed away 2 weeks before we opened. And then my sister that played the piano, Betty, she passed away a year. And then my brother Russell passed away the next year. So we've just kind of went here and there, but we all hang together as a family. And I think we're a very happy family. And we're all proud of our backgrounds.
Well, Roy Grimes a while ago was talking about the manships coming into the store and would come in and just never knew. They'd just come in and sit down and start playing.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, I'm amazed myself at what some of them can really do. And I feel like I got the least talent of all of them, really. I did.
I think somebody might disagree.
I disagree.
No.
Her talent goes beyond just playing and singing. She had the creative touch, the Bible schools and the ladies' meetings and all of that. Yeah.
Well, see, these magazines here have got a lot of history in them. They were printed for 2 years. The Tale of Vicinity, and by an old couple that knew a lot of history, and it tells a lot of things that we don't even think about now. It tells about, you know, the Confederates coming to and taking over Valeene here and holding them for ransom, and they had to feed them, and I think maybe give them a cow or something to eat. And then that was Hines, and Hines was going to, he was going to Paola, and there was a guy who got away on a fast horse and rode to Paola and warned them that the raiders was on the way. So they got ready and armed and had a, I don't know what they called it now, that protected the town, and they all got together and got their guns. And then what they didn't realize was that Hines or Morgan got, he also had a spy in Paola, and he ran back here and told them, said, don't go through Paola because they're waiting on you. So he goes within about 2 miles of Paola, turns left, and then goes up over the big hill down there where the Unionville Road is, and then he kind of veered to the west and crossed the paddle or the Lick Creek River down there on West Main Street and about where Mentworth Auto is now. Uh-huh. And then he surrounded Paola, and they said, of course, the biggest copperhead, you know what a copperhead was, he was referring to the people in this area that were sympathetic with the South. And the way they got their names, Copperhead, was because the guys were proud of it, and everybody wore overalls in, and the top button, they would take a copper penny and drill two little holes in it and use them for buttons on their overalls. But the head sympathizer for the southern part was a Dr. Bowles, and West Baden, and he was a rich man and had a lot to do with the development of the hotel and everything else down there. And he was known as a real good doctor. But if the Southerners had won World War II or the Civil War, he would have been the one over this whole part of the country. And of course they didn't. And then he later he went to prison, and then when he got out, he was an old man, and from then on, he was too old to, you know, to cause much trouble. But
Doc Bowles ended up in prison.
Yeah. Okay. And he was known as a good doctor and everything, but I think later they found out that even his credentials as a doctor was false. But he was known as, you know, he came from, around Hardinburg someplace, but he was the head sympathizer. And then also the Ku Klux Klan was alive in southern Indiana at that time. And I've got an article at home out of the Paola paper where, and I don't remember what year it is now, but they had a big rally at up on the square at Paola. And they used to have a bandstand up there on the square. And they even had a speaker up on the bandstand. And that was interesting, but there's a lot of history in those things.
So do you have every issue of Homespun?
No, I don't. I'm missing a few.
Uh-huh. But you got most of them for 2 years, because it looks like there's about 15 now.
Well, I don't know. This here is not a Homespun. That's it's got a lot of history. Now, one time I had a chance to buy a full set, and I messed around too long before I got there, and the guy had sold them or done something with them, and he didn't even remember what he'd done with them.
Yeah.
Well, I'm Alan Ray Manship, son of Everett and Chloe Manship.
And music has been a part of your life, your entire life?
Well, the music actually is not the Manships. The music comes from the Purtles, my mother. That's where the music come from, is the Purtle side.
Okay, and this is P-I-R-T-L-E, Purtle?
Right.
The music came from the Purtles.
Purtles, yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And just tell me the story of the music and how it got to you.
Well, my uncles all played music, the Purtles, Nopal and Hazel and Glennis. And I always was around them, and that's where I picked up my playing, from them guys.
Uh-huh. And what instruments did your uncles play?
Guitars. And
all
guitar
guitars.
And bass. Bass and guitars and bass is what they played. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah.
And now did your dad play?
No. So, Mom. It's all on my mom's side.
Side. Yeah. Okay. Some of the musicians that you've played with in the area over the years.
Lotus Dickey was my ex-father-in-law.
Uh-huh.
And John Moon. Carmen Walker, and Curtis Moon, all the Moons,
uh-huh.
And the Smelsers, Donnie Smelser,
yeah,
and Keith, and as his dad, Keith was his dad, and who else? There's so many of them, I can't even think.
So go ahead and talk about what Valeene means to you.
Well, it means a lot. This is where I was raised up in Valeene. And I went to school at Pearsontown, too, and Valeene both.
Went to the same Valeene school in the 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th grade. Same teacher in the 4 years.
Yeah, we was together all them years. Huh?
Tell them about the story. You went to Pearsontown.
Oh. Back when they broke the schools up, you know, they put...
Consolidation,
67?
Yeah,
they had the four younger grades down at Pearsontown, and the other four went to Valeene. And all my kinfolk, all my friends, they split me. I was the only one that had to go to Pearsontown away from my other friends. And I got mad. I said, I'm not going to Pearsontown. I'm going to Valeene. And I got off the bus up here at Valeene, and I was up on the board writing away. Norman Wells was the teacher.
Yeah.
Everybody looked back there and said, Miss White's coming up there. She's looking for Alan Manship. He's supposed to be in Pearsontown. And she come up there and grabbed me with the arm and drugged me through the school. I was trying to hang on chairs, you know. And she drugged me out and took me to school and said, you're going to Pearsontown.
You know, my dad went to school at Pearson Town, and he told a story one time that somebody had a rick or something of wood down along the side of the schoolhouse, and it was in the wintertime, and somebody picked up a horse biscuit and hit him in the nose with it and made his nose.
Well, there was competition between Pearson Town and
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
They always
yeah.
was.
Yep.
I mean, yep. The Strouds, I could, they would tell stories about
oh,
that.
I used to. Every Friday evening up here at Valeene School, when I went to come up here, Mr. Williams was our teacher, Arbor Williams from English, and he let me bring my guitar every Friday, and he'd let the school out about 2 hours early on Friday, and I'd play the guitar, and my sisters, Sharon, Connie, and Helen Kellums now, Helen Murphy, and Alan Strange used to sing and play for Mr. Williams in the school on Friday evening. He let us have the evening off.
You know how Alan Strange got his nickname?
Hoot, yeah. His grandma gave it to him.
No, he didn't. He did it his own self. When we play it, like you said, you get off the playing 2 or 3 hours of Friday evening, he push your stomach out like that, and it was the same big around as a basketball. And that's where he got his nickname. He done it himself.
All right. I didn't know that.
The cave where he first came is right under here. So he's buried not more than 150 feet from where he came in 1807 to Valeene, Indiana.